Passio Domini nostri Jesu Christi secundum Ioannem. In illo tempore egressus est Jesus cum discipulis suis transtorrentem cedron, ubi erat ortus in quem introibit ipse et discipuli eius. Sciebat autem et Iudas vitradebat eum locum, quia frequenter Iesus convenerat illucum discipulis suis. Iudas ergo cum accepis sed cohortem, et a pontificibus et fariseis ministros, venit illucum laternis et facibus et armis. Iesus itaque sciens omnia peventura erant super eum, processit et dixit eis.
Quem peritis?
Responderunt stabat autem et Iudas vitradebat eum cum ipsis. Ut ergo dixit eis ego sum, habierunt retror sum et ceciderunt in terram. Iterum ergo interrogavit eos.
Quem queritis?
Illi autem dixe respondit Iesus.
Dixi vobis quia ego sum, si ergo me queritis sinite os habile.
Ut impleretur sermo quem dixir, quia quos edissi mihi non perdidi exe quem quam. Simon ergo Petrus habens gladium eduxit eum, et percussit pontificis servum, et abscidit auriculam eius dexteram. Erat autem nomen servum malus. Dixit ergo Iesus
gradium tuum in vagina, caricem quem dedit mihi pater non vivam illum.
Cors ergo et tribunus et ministri judeorum comprehenderunt Iesum et ligaverunt eum et adduxerunt eum ad annam primum. Erat enim socer Caiphe, qui erat pontifex anni illius. Erat autem Caiphas, qui consilium dederat Iudeis, quia expedit unum hominem mori pro populum. Sequebatur autem Iesum Simon Petrus et alius discipulus. Discipulus autem ille erat notus pontifici, et introibit cum Iesu in atrium pontificis. Petrus autem stabat ad ostium foris. Exhibit ergo discipulus alius qui erat notus pontifici, et dixit ostiarie et introduxit Petrum. Dicit ergo Petro ancilla ostiaria.
Nunc videt tu ex discipulis ex hominis istim.
Dicit ille.
Nonus.
Stavant autem servi et ministri ad prunas, qui frigus erat, et cale facie panse. Erat autem cum eis et Petrus, stans et cale facie se. Pontifex ergo interrogavit Iesum de discipulis suis, et de doctrina ecus. Respondit
semper docui in synagoga et in templo quomnes Iudei conveniunt, et in occulto locutus sunnicil, quin me interrogas. Interroga eos qui audierunt qui locutus simim sis, et ceisium quae dixeri.
Ec autem cum dixisset, unus assistens ministrorum dedit ad apam Iesu dices.
Sic respondes pontifici.
Respondit
Iesus. Si male locutus sum testimonium peribide, si autem bene, quid me cedis?
Et misit eum annas ligatum ad Caiphas pontificem. Erat autem Simon Petrus, stans et cale faciens de. Dixerunt ergo ei,
nunc videt tu ex discipulis eius?
Negavit ille et dixit,
non sum.
Dicit eius ex servis pontificis, cognatus eius cuius ascidit Petrus auricula.
Non nego te vidino tocumil.
Iterum ergo negavit Petrus, et statim gallus cantavit. Anducunt ergo Iesum a Caipha in praetorium. Erat autem manae, et ipsi non introierunt in praetorium, ut non contaminarentur, sed ut manducarent pasca. Exhibit ergo Pilatus ad eos foras, et dixit.
Quam accusationem affertis adversus hominem?
Responderunt et dixerunt ei,
si honest et ignare facto, non timit hominis rebus.
Dixit ergo eis Pilatus.
Ancipit eus, et secundum legem vestram judicate.
Dixerunt ergo ei Iudei.
Nobis non licet, inter fischere quemquam.
Ut sermo Iesu impleretur quem dixit, significans quam morte esser moritur. Introibit ergo iterum in praetorium Pilatus, et vocabit Iesum mendicit ei.
Tu es rex Iudeorum.
Respondit Iesum.
Atem et ipsum dicis, sanarit exeunt tibi demi.
Respondit Pilatus.
Nun quid ego Iudeus gestua et pontifices padit Deum te mihi, quid fecisti?
Respondit Iesus.
Regnum meum non est de ex hoc mundo esset regnum meum, ministri meo titui decertaret, non tadere iudeis. Nun caudem, regnum meum non est hinc.
Dixidit atque Pilatus.
Ergo rex est tu.
Respondit Iesus.
Tu dicis quia rex sumendum. Ego in hoc natu sum et ad hoc veni in mundum. Un testimonium per imeam veritatem. Omnis qui est ex veritatem audit vocem meam.
Dicidei Pilatus.
Quid est veritas?
El cum hoc dixisset, iterum exhibit ad Iudeos endicit eis.
Ego nullam in venio in eo causa, est autem consuetudo vobis, ut unum dimittam vobis in pausa. Vultis ergo dimittam vobis, regem Iudeos.
I was with the crowds gathered round him like a king, whose smiling faces joined a sea of branches waving, though they were masquerading in the air. And my heart arose in my throat when I heard them sing, Hosanna. In the highest, take him up the mountainside where he was crucified for innocent. And they mocked him and they cursed him with their mouths, and he told them to come down if he was God. And my heart broke Jesus, help us to never forget the ultimate sacrifice that you paid. Through the torture and the mockery and everything that you endured on those 6 hours as you hung on the cross. You did it, Lord. You did it so that we could live. God, you didn't save yourself. Because you knew that you were saving us. So with hearts full of gratitude and humility tonight, Lord, we remember the suffering and the sorrow of our Savior. God, let us be moved to remember why you went through these lengths for us. So that we might love you more. And love sin less. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Well, thanks for joining us tonight on this Good Friday evening. My name's Nate, and I just want to retell the story of what took place on that day. That Jesus gave his life to rescue all of us from sin. And I want to start by just going to the Word of God and looking to the Scriptures. Let's start in the book of Isaiah. The Bible says, he was despised and rejected by men, a man of sorrows, acquainted with grief, and as one from whom men hide their faces. When he was despised and we esteemed him not. Surely he has borne our griefs and carried our sorrows, yet we esteemed him stricken, smitten by God, and afflicted. But he was pierced for our transgressions, and he was crushed for our iniquities, and upon him was the chastisement that brought us peace. And with his wounds, we are healed. Jesus began with his disciples on this journey to the cross in the upper room, and he predicts his death again to them. This is now the third time that he tells them that he is going to go to his death, but he is going to rise again. And this is what he says in the Gospels. He says, and Jesus said to them, you will fall away. He says, you will all fall away. For it's written, I will strike the shepherd, and the sheep will be scattered. But after I am raised up, I will go before you to Galilee. And then Peter just wanted to cut him off and stopped him, saying, even though they all fall away, Lord, I will not. Jesus turns his attention to Peter, and he says to him, truly I tell you, this very night before the rooster crows twice, you will deny me three times. All the while, One of his best friends, Judas, had been conspiring against Jesus, and he had been working with the high priests and the scribes to be able to find a way to give him into their captivity. And so for 30 pieces of silver, Judas sold Jesus into the hands of the Jews. That was about $1,000 in today's money. Later, after he realizes that Jesus is crucified as a result of his betrayal, Judas goes and commits suicide. But before we get to the cross, there was Gethsemane. After the disciples left the upper room, Jesus went to pray in the Garden of Gethsemane, and you could see his suffering, and you could see the weight of what he was about to go into at the cross upon him as he prayed. And he prayed with such agony that the physician, Luke, records this in his gospel. In Luke 22, it says, talking about Jesus, it says, "In being in agony, he prayed longer, and his sweat became as drops of blood trickling down upon the ground." In modern day medicine, we know this is hematidrosis, or bloody sweat. And this actually happens when someone is under so much duress, so much stress, that it causes the capillaries and the blood vessels in one's skin to burst, and they mix with your sweat glands, and you literally sweat drops of blood. And this is what Jesus was doing there in the garden. And after he finishes praying, there's a group of soldiers coming that were sent from the high priest. And Judas was with this group of men, and he told them, he said, "The one that I kiss is the one that you need to arrest." And he walks up to Jesus, and his friend Judas greets him with a kiss. And Jesus looks at Judas and says, "You betray me with a kiss." Identifying that it was Jesus that they needed to arrest, they came and they tied him up and placed him in shackles and carried him off to begin his illegal trial. You see, there were six parts to Jesus' trial. The first three parts were in a religious court, and then the last three were in a Roman court. And the night of Jesus' arrest, they brought him before Annas and before Caiaphas, the high priest, and an assembly of religious leaders that they called the Sanhedrin. The Sanhedrin was made up of 71 judges. There were 70 lower court judges, and the high priest was the 71st judge. There were also three scribes, and they had some simple jobs. One scribe was to count the votes to convict the accused. The other scribe was to count the votes to acquit the accused. And then the third scribe was to count both, just to hold the first two scribes accountable for what they had written down. But on this night, none of that mattered, because Jesus' trials, they were illegal by the standards of the Sanhedrin on so many levels. No trial was supposed to be held during Passover feast time, and it is feast time when they're putting Jesus on trial. So that was illegal. No trial was supposed to be held at night. They were all in the light of day. And they actually, the Jews considered these trials and the time that the Sanhedrin would gather as worship to God. And so they didn't want anything done at night, but yet this took place at night. Again, it was illegal. If the death penalty was given, which, by the way, the Jews didn't even have the right to enforce the death penalty, only the Romans that were occupying their land could do that. But if the death penalty was given, a night had to pass before the sentence would be carried out. In fact, they went through such lengths to make sure that they were not going to condemn an innocent man to death that during that day that had to transpire after the death sentence was given, they sent out a herald, they sent out a flag bearer, and they sent out a caller, a crier, that walked through the city. They were blowing a trumpet, waving a flag, and calling out to people saying, "If there's anyone that has evidence that this person that's accused of this crime is innocent, come forward now," so that they could preserve the life of innocent people. But this was non-existent for Jesus. This court was the defense of the accused, and it was known around the world as being the only kind of court like it. It was unprecedented, but not for Jesus' trial because they were all looking to convict him and sentence him to death. In fact, they weren't even allowed to ask self-incriminating questions of the accused. But Jesus was asked directly if he was the Christ so that they could convict him of blasphemy. Mark chapter 14 tells us this. In verse 55, it says, the chief priests and the whole Sanhedrin were looking for evidence against Jesus so that they could put him to death, but they could not find any. Many falsely testified against Jesus, but their statements didn't agree. In other words, one person would come forth and say, oh yes, I saw him committing these crimes at these times, and they'd have someone else come forth with another false testimony saying, yeah, he was doing these crimes at these times, so how could he have been doing these things at the same time? It didn't make sense. And their testimonies didn't add up. And the high priest realizes we're just wasting time here. And so he gets in Jesus' face and he says, are you not going to answer? What is this testimony that these men are bringing against you? But Jesus, he remained silent and he gave no answer to the high priest. And again, the high priest asked him, he said, are you the Messiah? Are you the Son of the Blessed One? Are you the Son of God? He just asked him directly, what do you think? And Jesus then looks back at the high priest and he says, I am. And the high priest immediately tears his clothes and he says, why do we need any more witnesses? You have heard this blasphemy. And they all condemned him as worthy of death. Verse 65, it says, then some began to spit at him, and they blindfolded him, and they struck him with their fists, mocking him. They said, prophesy. And the guards took him and beat him. And it was believed that this is where they actually ripped the hair out of Jesus' beard in clumps as they mocked him and beat him. And then he left the Sanhedrin, bloody and bruised and abused, and he went before Pontius Pilate, who was the Roman prefect, effectively the governor of that province of the world ruled by Rome. And Jesus there was charged with inciting people to riot or sedition. He was charged with forbidding people to pay their taxes. And he was charged with claiming to be king. But Pilate found no reason to kill Jesus. And he didn't want to have Jesus' blood on his hands, so he sent him to Herod Antipas, who was a local ruler that Rome had backed and established there. Herod, he had Jesus ridiculed and he mocked him, but he wanted to avoid the political liability of actually bringing harm to Jesus, so he sent him right back to Pilate, where he stood before him for his last trial. And Pilate then tried to appease the animosity of the Jews, the crowd that wanted him to die. And to do this, instead of having him crucified, he did the next worst thing, which was to have him scourged. See, in Rome, a prisoner would have his clothing stripped off completely. He would have his hands tied to a post above his head. And the Jewish law said that you would receive 39 lashes. But we're not dealing with Jewish law. You see, this was Roman law. And Roman law simply said you take the flagrum, which is a whip that had metal balls tied into the ends of the whip, and rock and bone and glass tied into leather strips of the whip. And you beat that guilty person until they're within an inch of their life. And when the soldier beating that person believed they were about to die, that's when they stopped the flogging. So Jesus has this heavy whip brought down with full force again and again across his shoulders and his back and his legs. And then all of a sudden, these deep bruises appear and the skin breaks and he's got blood everywhere. He's bleeding out to the point where his flesh is being tattered and ripped apart, strike upon strike upon strike, unrelenting as Jesus is there tied with his hands above his head, receiving these lashes again and again and again. And then finally, the centurion in charge thinks that Jesus is near the point of death, and they stop the beating. But it doesn't just stop there. They just decide after he's viciously beaten, he's bleeding out, he's barely breathing at this point, that they're going to mock him. And so they say, oh, you're a Jew claiming to be a king. So they throw a robe across his bleeding shoulders, and they place a stick in his hand for a scepter. And they have these flexible branches that are covered with these 3-inch thorns. And it was very common that these people would use these thorny pieces of wood for firewood. But these Roman soldiers took these pieces of thorned wood and fashioned them into a crown. And they placed it upon Jesus' head, pressed it down into his scalp, and more blood began to flow. And after mocking him, they'd strike him across the face. And then the soldiers would take the stick out of Jesus' hand, and they would strike him across the head with its stick. And finally, they get tired of just making fun of him and beating and abusing him after he's been scourged within an inch of his life. And they took the robe that was on his back, that at this time his body had responded to that by treating it like another skin. And his blood had begun to clot after this piece of fabric had rested on his back over the wounds from the Roman flagrum. And the soldiers went and grabbed it and ripped it off his back again, exposing his internal organs through his rib cage to the sunlight. In agony, they took Jesus and they brought him out in front of the crowd. Pilate was shocked that Jesus could bear such a punishment and still stand on his own 2 feet, to the point where he looked out into the crowd and he said, "Behold the man," as if to say, "Is this not enough?" In hopes that he could change the crowd's mind, knowing that once a year they could release a prisoner, he offers to free Jesus. And what happens is they'll bring out 2 prisoners and they let the crowd decide. They bring out Jesus of Nazareth. No one could bring a charge against him. No one could find him guilty. Yet here he stands, beaten and mocked and scorned. And then he brings out another Jesus. This man was named Jesus Barabbas, who was a violent man, who was a known criminal. And no one had any qualms as to why he was going to face execution before Rome, because they knew his criminal history. And Pilate said, "Which one do you want? Surely you won't take this man that would be an immediate danger to all of Jerusalem if he's to be released and go free. Surely you would want to release Jesus of Nazareth." And the crowd cried, "Give us Barabbas, the criminal, the murderer. Crucify Jesus of Nazareth." The irony of this decision was that Jesus Barabbas, his name Barabbas, Bar Abbas, means son of the Father. Some translations say his name was Jesus, son of the Heavenly Father. And it makes the words of the scripture in Isaiah ring through my mind. "He was despised and rejected by men, a man of sorrows, this Jesus, acquainted with grief, and as one from whom men hide their faces, he was despised, and they esteemed him not. Surely he has borne our griefs, carried our sorrows, yet we esteemed him stricken, smitten by God, and afflicted." And then Jesus was ordered to be crucified. You see, the trials of Jesus represent the ultimate mockery of justice. Jesus, the most innocent man in the history of the world, was found guilty of crimes and sentenced to death by crucifixion. Crucifixion was one of the most gruesome and the most painful way to die. And it wasn't just an execution. It was Rome's way of trying to exterminate the memory of someone from written history. In most circumstances with crucifixion, you're not allowed a burial. Your body is to hang on the cross until your flesh rots from your bones. And then they send someone along with a club weeks later to knock the bones off the cross, to gather them together and have them burned outside of town. Crucifixion was a practice that was invented by the Persians, and then Alexander the Great brought it back to Egypt and then to Carthage. And in Carthage, that's where the Romans learned about crucifixion. And like most things with the Romans, they decided that they could get better at it, that they could improve it, that they could make it more painful and more excruciating. Literally, the word excruciating comes from the word crucifixion because of this incredibly high degree of pain. So the Romans, they returned Jesus' garments to him after he had been flogged. And then they take a portion of the cross that was about 110 pounds. Obviously, there's two pieces to that cross. They tied it across his shoulders, and then the procession headed towards Golgotha. It was Jesus, two other criminals, the Roman centurions, and the people that would be driving the nails into their hands and to their feet. And they'd begun the slow journey along the Via Dolorosa, about 650 feet up the hill, to where he would be ultimately crucified for the sins of the world. Jesus, being exhausted, having his blood drained from his body due to the scourging that he had endured, the sleepless night that he had endured the night before, the beatings that he had been taking literally all night until he went to the scourging of the Romans, leaves him exhausted. He can't bear the weight of that piece of the cross, and so he falls down to the ground. And a Roman centurion orders a man named Simon of Cyrene to carry the cross. And then Jesus follows behind him, still bleeding and sweating from this cold, clammy sweat of shock that he's in, until he reaches Golgotha, otherwise known as the place of the skull. Once he gets there, Jesus is stripped completely naked, humiliated before the crowds of people there. And the soldiers divided up his clothes, and then they gambled. They cast lots to win his seamless tunic. And that was fulfilling the prophecy in Psalm 22, 18, where it said, "They divided my garments among them, and for my clothes they cast lots." Before Jesus is nailed to the tree, he's offered wine that's mixed with myrrh, and that's supposed to be a painkiller, but he refuses to drink this, keeping all of his wits about him. And the nails were driven between the small bones of his wrists, between the radial and the ulna, and not through the palms. And the patibulum, that heavy piece of the cross that Jesus had to carry uphill, was then lifted in place at the top of the other piece of the cross known as the stipes. And then above that, they nailed a sign which was known as a titulus. And that sign said, "Jesus of Nazareth, King of the Jews, is nailed here in this place." Nails are then driven through the arches of each of his feet that are stacked up one on top of the other, leaving the knees moderately flexed, and he slowly sags down with more weight on the nails that are in his wrists. And this is what causes that pain that we know as excruciating pain. And it shoots along his fingers, up through his arms, and just sends an explosion to the pain sensors in his brain. And then he feels more and more pressure, and he pushes himself upward to avoid this stretching torment, and he places his full weight on the nail that's driven through both of his feet. His muscles begin to cramp and tire, so he can finally breathe a little bit, but he can breathe in, and he has trouble breathing out because this is part of the torture of the cross. So Jesus fights to raise himself up in order to let the air out and then breathe it in again. And finally, he's able to speak. During the 6 hours that he hung on the cross, he said 7 short phrases that were recorded in the Gospels in the New Testament. And the first one he said when he was looking down at the Roman soldiers that were gambling for his own clothes. And he said, Father, forgive them, for they know not what they do. And then one of the thieves that was hanging beside him began to mock him like others did, saying, if you really are God, save yourself. But Jesus knew that he could not save himself if he was going to save us from sin. And another one to his other side looked at him and said to the thief that was mocking him, this man has done nothing. We deserve what we're getting, but he is innocent. Looking over to Jesus, he said, would you remember me when you come into your heavenly kingdom? And Jesus, in that moment, hanging there on the cross, looked at that thief with love and with mercy, even in his last moments. And he said, surely today you will be with me in paradise. A short while later, after all of his disciples had scattered, only John and his mother Mary were left. And he looked down at them. To his mother, he said, woman, behold your son. And then he said to John, behold your mother. Taking a moment to say, I want to make sure that my mother is cared for. And they would care for one another. And then at noon, darkness covered the entire land. In the middle of the day, it became night. And Jesus then had the full bearing of the sins of the world placed upon himself, and he cried out to God the Father, saying, Elohi, Elohi, lama sabachthani, which means, my God, why have you forsaken me? It was because Jesus himself had borne our sins. Like the scripture says, he became sin that knew no sin, that we might become the righteousness of God. Shortly after that, he said, I thirst. His body completely drained of fluids. They put a sponge that had wine on it, on a hyssop branch, and lifted it up to him. The gospel records that he drank, and then he uttered the words, it is finished. And then he said, Father, into your hands I commit my spirit, knowing that the work that he had done in this life and the work that he had done on the cross to free the world from sin was completed. And the Gospel of Mark records it like this. At that moment when Jesus breathed his last breath, it says, the curtain of the temple was torn in two from top to bottom. And in the temple in Jerusalem, there were two curtains. One was visible to the public, and the other was between the interior and the Holy of Holies, the most holy place in the temple. And that curtain there that separated God from man and the holiest place was ripped in two. It was like he was giving us a visual illustration of what Jesus had done on the cross. The separation from God and man because of sin was done away with. The old was ending. God was signaling that through the sacrifice of his son, Jesus, something new and better and all-encompassing had come. And there would be no more separation between God and all of mankind because the covenant between God and the human race was officially ratified. And Jesus' blood was the payment for our sins. Remember, 1 Peter 2:24 says, he himself bore our sins in his body on the cross. So all of the wrong that you've ever done in your lifetime, Jesus on the cross bore that sin upon himself so that you and I could be forgiven. In order that the Sabbath would not be profaned, the Jews asked that the condemned men be dispatched and removed from the crosses. And what they would do to end a crucifixion quickly was called crurifracture. And this was the breaking of bones. Basically, they would have the soldiers walk up with clubs and break the legs of the people that were crucified so that they would suffocate and die. They couldn't breathe hanging by their wrists on the cross. And they saw that Jesus had already died, so they didn't break his legs, fulfilling a prophecy that says, the scripture, it was fulfilled saying not one of his bones would be broken. In another scripture, it even says, they will look on him who they have pierced. And that was another fulfillment of prophecy when a soldier, just to make sure that Jesus was dead, took his spear and pushed it into his side. And it says, when he removed the spear, blood and water flowed. And this tells us how Jesus came to his death. It wasn't that he suffocated because he couldn't breathe on the cross. It was because fluid had filled up this sac around his heart called the pericardium, to the point where Jesus had a heart attack and died. And the greatest person that the world has ever known there on the cross was dead. And it wasn't for nothing. It wasn't because he just fell into the hands of the Jews and the Romans. No, Jesus knew exactly where he was going. The moment he entered into the city of Jerusalem, what we know as Palm Sunday, he knew that he was going to his death. He knew that his hour had finally come. And freely and willingly, he laid down his life for you and for me so that we could be set free from sin. There is no other love that has ever been known in the world like this, that has been given freely to you and to me. And as we remember the sorrow, as we remember the suffering, as we remember all that Jesus went through on this darkest of days in our history, I would be remiss if I didn't give you an opportunity to personally receive the gift that Jesus made available to the world when he gave his life. And that is the gift of forgiveness. Jesus went through all of this for you to be forgiven. Because he loves you, because he knows your name. And there's nothing you could ever do to outsin the grace that he gives to you. There's nothing you could ever do to outsin the love that he has for you. There's nothing you could ever do to make yourself ready to receive this free gift of his forgiveness that he has given for you. It's not about how good or how bad you are. It's about the fact that there is a God in heaven that did not want to be separated from his creation, and that's you and me. And so he gave his very life as a payment for all the wrongdoing that you and I have ever done. Because any of us, the Bible tells us, any of us that have sinned, it causes us to become guilty of God's judgment. And all of us have sinned in some way or another. The scripture tells us all have sinned and fallen short of God's glory. It also says, but while we were yet sinners, while we were at the worst of who we are, Christ died for us. You see, Jesus made this gift of forgiveness because of his death and the payment for sin available to you and to me. And if you'd like to receive that free gift tonight, I'm going to encourage you just to pray this very, very simple prayer with me. But you make these words real in your heart as you talk to God. Why don't you pray something like this? Jesus, I believe that you bore my sins for me on your body as you hung on the cross. And I place my faith in you as my Savior and as my Lord. Thank you for forgiving me of my sin. I'm turning away from my old life, and I'm turning to you. I surrender my life to you, Jesus. I want your spirit to live inside me, and I want you to live your life through me. I pray that you would take this old spirit out of me and place a new spirit in me. I want to live for you for the rest of my days. It's in Jesus' name I pray. Amen. Hey, I'm so glad that you joined us on this Good Friday. Now I'm going to ask you simply to escape into the shadows of this dark night, but remembering that even though it's Friday, Sunday's coming.
Passio Domini nostri Jesu Christi secundum Ioannem. In illo tempore egressus est Jesus cum discipulis suis transtorrentem cedron, ubi erat ortus in quem introibit ipse et discipuli eius. Sciebat autem et Iudas vitradebat eum locum, quia frequenter Iesus convenerat in locum discipulis suis. Iudas ergo cum accepisset cohortem, et a pontificibus et fariseis ministros, venit in locum laternis et facibus et armis. Iesus itaque sciens omnia peventura erant super eum, processit et dixit
quem queridis?
Responderunt stabat autem et Iudas vitradebat eum cum ipsis. Ut ergo dixit eis ego sum, habierunt retrorsum et ceciderunt in terram. Iterum ergo interrogavit eos.
Quem queridis?
Illi autem dixe Simon ergo Petrus habens gladium eduxit eum, et percussit pontificis servum, et abscidit auriculam eius dexteram. Erat autem nomen servum malus, dixit ergo Iesus Petrus.
Mitte gladium tu caricem quem dedit mihi pater non vivam illum.
Cors ergo et tribunus et ministri judeorum comprehendeunt Iesum et ligaverunt eum et adducerunt eum ad annam primum. Erat enim socer Caiphe, qui erat pontifex anni. Erat autem Caiphas, qui consilium dederat Iudeis, quia expedit unum hominem mori pro populum. Sequebatur autem Iesum Simon Petrus et alius discipulus. Discipulus autem ille erat notus pontifici, et introibit cum Iesu in atrium pontificis. Petrus autem stabat ad ostium fortis. Exhibit ergo discipulus alius qui erat notus pontifici, erdixit ostiarie et introduxit Petrum. Dicit ergo Petro ancilla ostiaria.
Nunc quidet tu ex discipulis ex hominis isti?
Dicit ille.
Non
stavant autem servi et ministriat prunas, qui affrigus erat, et cale facie panse. Erat autem cum eis et Petrus, stans et cale facie se. Pontifex ergo interrogavit Iesum de discipulis suis, et de doctrinae. Respondite